stand ovation for bringing up this bomb. Come on, y'all, give y'all a hand. Thank you, sir. Thank you for being in my life. I thank God for my pastor, one of the greatest pastors I know. I thank Reverend Evans for one of the greatest brothers I have in the ministry that supports me. And I thank God for each and every one. And I have a word to say that comes from the social minister, Reverend Evans here. We want to thank you. We want to thank you. We want to thank you for your support. And we love you. And we will be kissing you at the end of the door. And we appreciate you. And we thank God for your support.
Amen.
So all the social minister, that's all the social minister in our time.
Amen. Amen.
The subject today, more than conquerors. We're more than conquerors. And we know this in all things. God worked for the good of those that love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those who God has chosen? It is God who justified. Who is he that condemned? Christ Jesus, who died. More than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God, and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, or hardship, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Not in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any power, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Let us pray. Our Father, I ask you to anoint the healers. I let somebody walk by. They said, what we must do to be saved? Oh, Lord, touch each and every one, Lord. And I ask you to bless us. And I know that you can heal us. All we have to do is say, Lord, heal us. Don't say, I'm going to be sick. If you want to be sick, you got to say, Lord, I am healed by your stripes. I am healed. I thank you, Lord, for your healing. I thank you for your teaching. I thank you for the Holy Ghost that keep us. And I ask you to watch over our pastor and keep him. And I ask you to watch over Reverend Evans. And I ask you to watch over all those social ministers. Keep us and bring us through, Lord. And bring all the children of Mount Zion through. And I ask you to bless the children as Reverend. He's trying to teach them the way of the Lord. Help Buchanan right now, Lord, with the children. And we thank you and we bless your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God works in all things, not just isolated incidents, for our good. This does not mean that all that happened to us is good. Evil is prevalent in our fallen world. But God is able to turn every circumstance around for our long-range good. Note that God is not working to make us happy, but to fulfill his purpose. Note also that his promise is not for everybody. It can be claimed only by those who love God and are called according to his purpose.
That's right.
Those who are called are those the Holy Spirit convinces and able to receive Christ. Such people have a new perspective, a new mindset on life. They trust in God, not life treasure. They look for their security in heaven, not on earth. They learn to accept, not resent, pain and persecution because God is with them. God's ultimate goal for us is to make us like Christ. 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. As we become more and more like him, we discover our true self, the person we were created to be. How can we be conformed to Christ's likeness? By reading and heeding the word, by studying his life on earth through the gospel, by being filled with his spirit, and by doing his work in the world. Some believe these verses mean that before the beginning of the world, God chose certain people to receive his gift of salvation. They point to verses like Ephesians 1, verse 11, that say we are predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will. Others believe that God foreknew those who would respond to him upon those he set his mark, predestined. What is clear is that God's purpose for people was not in outdoor. It was settled before the foundation of the world.
Said, preacher.
People are to serve and honor God.
That's right.
If you have believed in Christ, you can rejoice in the fact that God has always known you.
That's
God's love is eternal.
Right.
His wisdom and power are supreme. He will guide and protect you until you one day stand in his presence.
Said, preacher.
Call being summoned or invited. For more of justification and glorification, see chapter 3. Do you ever think that because you are good enough for God, he will not save you? Do you ever feel as if salvation is for everyone else but you? That these verses are especially for you. If God gave his son for you, he isn't going to hold back the gift of salvation. If Christ gave his life for you, he isn't going to turn around and condemn you. He will not withhold anything you need to live for him. The book of Romans is more than a theological explanation of God's redeeming grace. It's a letter of comfort and confidence addressed to you. Paul says that Jesus is interceding for us in heaven.
That's right.
God has acquitted us, and has removed our sin and guilt. So it is Satan, not God, who accuses us. When he does, Jesus, the advocate for our defense, stand at God's right hand to present our case. For more on the concept of Christ as our effort, see the note on Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14.
Said preacher.
These words were written to a church that would soon undergo terrible persecution. In just a few years, Paul's hypothetical situation would turn into painful reality. This passage reaffirms God's profound love for his people. No matter what happened to us, and no matter where we are, we can never be lost in his love. Right. Suffering should not drive us away from God, but help us to identify with him further and allow his love to reach us and heal us. These verses contain one of the most confident promises in all Scripture. Believers have always had to face hardship in many forms, persecution, illness, imprisonment, even death. These could cause them to feel that they have been abandoned by Christ. But Paul explained that it is impossible to be separated from Christ. His death for us is proof of his unquenchable love. Nothing can stop Christ's constant presence with us. God tells us how great his love is so that we will feel total security. If we believe these overwhelming and assurance, we will not be afraid. Powers are unseen, forces of evil in the universe, forces like Satan and his fallen angels. See Ephesians 6, verse 12. In Christ, we are super conquerors, and his love will protect us from all any soul and forces on earth. That's why we have to stand up and give God some glory. Because the first one I like to spread is the love. Now, Jesus loves us first. A lot of people say, you love Jesus, but he loved us first. That's why we're here today. He woke us up this early this morning and started. Well, come on, y'all. Help me pray, Mount Zion. Come on, y'all. Jesus is the love of our life. Jesus, he will be his faith. He will be his world, and he is our king. And Jesus. excited. Come on, y'all, we're going to pray Jesus more. And the second one, I read in the hope we have. You got to have hope in Jesus. The word of God from the Lamb of God, you got to have hope that we stand up for Jesus. And the hope that he gives us, no man can give it to us, no woman can give it to us, no child can give it to us. And only Jesus gave the hope that I'm talking about. The hope I'm talking about that he died for us today. And I'm so excited about Jesus. I can't stop talking about Jesus. Sometimes I get up out there on a Saturday morning and go to witness for Jesus. I tell this dying world, if you don't got Jesus, you won't die in your sin. You got to help and give Jesus your life, because you can try everything in this world. You can try all the drugs. You can try to drink all your life away. But the day ain't going to be the same. But if you got the love and the hope in Jesus, you're going to make everything all right. Come on, brown eyes, help me praise our Jesus. Come on, mama, and I promise you. Come on, y'all, help me praise. And the third point, I like to stress in Jesus. When you got Jesus, all you got to say, Jesus, Satan has to flee. All you got to say, Jesus, Satan has to flee. That's all you got to do. When he come on my trail, I know he gonna come. Cause when Jesus used me on the Sunday morning, I know the devil gonna come from different angles. But I got to say in my life, he can do in the name of Jesus. And then he has to flee. Come on, y'all. Help me pray in our Jesus. And they took their head out Jesus. And they couldn't do Jesus. But Jesus said, no, I would lay my life down for us. And when Jesus went down, I'm going to peace of God, which passes all